All right. Good morning, everyone. Thank you so much for being here today. My name is Tucker Jones. I'm the one who sends you out all of the emails. So I really appreciate you being able to attend today's event. It's a very special event. We have one of our fantastic teachers here at Kansas State University presenting on how to make our classes as engaging as possible, how to use the tools that we have available to us. We are recording today's event on Zoom, so that's why I went through and placed mics throughout the room. So if you have a question, just so we can make sure that it's getting picked up and so our Zoom audience members can hear it, if you could just grab one of the mics close to you, push it. When the light turns green, it'll be active. The mic will be hot. You can speak into it. It'll pick you up very clearly. But we just want to make sure that everybody can hear what you have to say. If you need a handout, raise your hand. I'll come around and make sure that you get one of those. Otherwise, it is my pleasure to introduce today's speaker. So he is a professor in the architecture department. I forget the entire name of the department. I apologize. The Department of Architecture. He is a fantastic instructor. He is a former Kauffman Chair, which is the highest honor bestowed on our teachers here at Kansas State University. So please help me in welcoming Dr. Mick Charney.
Okay, so let's find out a little bit about who we all are, some demographics, if you will, okay? So how much Neanderthal DNA is in the average modern human? Anybody have a guess? I'd be willing to guess that everybody in this room has a little bit of Neanderthal DNA. At least that's what evolving science tells us about DNA. How much? Anybody have a guess?
Less than
1%. Less than 1%? Any other guesses? 5%? Any other guesses? Okay, well, what you see here is a series of figures there representing modern humans, those black silhouetted figures. Altogether, there are 100 of them, so each figure represents 1%. How much DNA do we have in us on average? If that's 1% there, a little Neanderthal with his animal skin loincloth and club, how many more do we have to add? Anywhere from 1 to 4%. That's how much we have on average of Neanderthal DNA. Everybody here in this room, somewhere in that range. Okay, so look at that guy there. That's the most ridiculously good looking Neanderthal. Our forensic science is able to reconstruct what he would have looked like. L'homme de spi, he was found in Belgium. Okay, and all right, so now, given the fact that we all have Neanderthal DNA, here's another interesting fact. We all have slightly different portions of Neanderthal DNA. So my string of Neanderthal DNA is different from yours, is different from yours, is different from yours. But if we take all of those together, how much of a Neanderthal can we recreate? What percentage? Have a number in mind? Okay. Anybody want to guess before I show you? How much of a Neanderthal can we recreate? Watch. Yeah, 40%, 40%, up to 40%. Unbelievable, right? Let me ask you a question. As things were changing and transitioning there, animations, if you will, what questions did you have in your mind? How'd you do that? That's one of the questions. How did you do that? Okay, get a little tongue-tied sometimes. What's the other question? Think of yourself as a student in an anthropology class or something like that. What's the question you're asking? Yeah.
Why not the whole DNA is transferred to the other people? Because, I mean, we are like, I don't know the population of the world, but we are a ton. Uh-huh. And we have like from 1 to 4%. I was thinking, well, maybe we can reproduce everything. a lot of people that serve different parts of DNA.
Okay, so maybe we can produce 100% of a Neanderthal.
Yes.
Is your question? Okay, so the basic question that you're asking is, gee, I wonder when that's going to stop. Were you asking yourself, once you saw those figures appear, the white silhouettes, were you asking yourself, gee, it went past where I thought it would be, or it stopped far short of where I thought it would be? In your case, it stopped far short of what you thought it might be. You thought maybe perhaps something closer to 100%. Isn't that the sort of question that you want your students to be asking in class, especially when you're using PowerPoint? And you can use animations and transitions in PowerPoint to get them to start to think critically in their own mind. They can engage with the material in that way. You don't have to say a thing as the instructor. Hopefully they're looking at this and they're asking those questions. Now, let me show you. Oh, we can take a Neanderthal, shave him, give him a haircut, put him in a suit, and yeah, he'd fit in. Okay, so let me ask you a question. Is that more effective, what you just saw, or is this more effective? Less effective, right? You aren't getting the students engaged. You aren't getting them thinking. So that's some of the stuff that you can do with PowerPoint. Okay, now, anybody get any of these ancestry tests like 23andMe? And did you find anything unusual about yourself, your DNA? Anybody? What'd you find out, if you don't mind sharing? You don't have to.
So I thought that my father is from Peru, from the Andes.
Uh-huh.
And I thought that majority would be Andean.
Uh-huh.
And it is not. It's just like 23%.
Oh, I see.
With a lot of European, Eastern Europeans showing up.
And you didn't expect the Eastern European?
My mother is
maybe a little.
So
oh, really?
It, but, you know, it was way more than that.
Yeah. Come in style, G. Come sta oggi? Italiano. Va bene. Okay, so I found out that I have just a little bit of East Asian native indigenous Siberian in me. I thought, oh my gosh, where'd that come from? So there's my Neanderthal DNA, about 1.5%. Now I can tell you I have 0.3% Siberian in me, but I can show it to you this way, using numbers, big bold numbers, that makes an impression. Or I can show you the original pie chart I got, and look at that salmon color there, just stands out like a sore thumb. Or I can do this, put a little salmon colored Siberian figure up there and start to change those black silhouetted figures, and that's my Siberian DNA. Incidentally, the woman in the upper right hand corner, she looks an awful like a lot like my great aunt Helen, but that's another story, I guess. Or I can show you this, a sort of family tree. There I am at the center, right? And of course, the two segments that you see just above my head, that's mom and dad. And then the four above that is grandma and grandpa on both sides. That goes back 9 generations before me, okay? And so what I can do, what's interesting is all those rectangles that you see there, every one of those hundreds of people back 9 generations contributed to my DNA. Isn't that amazing just to see it in that format? But I can show you where my Siberian is, right there. Okay, that one person, but it came down to me all those generations. Now, I don't know if you know this little trick or not. Let me show you. But there's a tool on PowerPoint down below here, when you're working with your laptop, you'll see a sort of spyglass, which normally symbolizes search, but it also symbolizes magnify. So if you click on that spyglass, and then you can move this around here and zoom in like that, okay? The reason I mention this is a lot of times in our PowerPoints, we put a lot of information on one slide. Some of it gets to be very, very, very small, especially when projected on a screen. It might be suitable when the student is reviewing that PowerPoint on their laptops through our LMS systems, our learning management systems like Canvas. But in class, maybe tiny little writing like that, small fonts don't show up so well. So you can use that magnifying option or tool on PowerPoint. And then all you have to do is hit escape, and you go back to the full screen like that. Okay, so let's find out a little bit about you, all right? Some live action infographics, if you will. I'm kind of interested in what disciplines you teach. So let's divide it into 3 broad areas. Let's say the hard sciences, in other words, the STEM courses, that would be one. let's say arts and humanities would be the second one, and let's say social sciences would be the third one, okay? So let's see, let everybody raise your hand if you're in the hard sciences. And someone, okay, how about people in arts and humanities, okay? And the social sciences, okay? So we've got a fair mix here. Okay, now I want you to do this for me. Everybody as a group, I want you to raise your hand, but indicate with your fingers how often you use PowerPoint in your classes. So that all five fingers raised means you use it all the time. Zero fingers, you use it hardly ever, okay? So think about how often you would use it on that scale, 0 to 5. And show me, how often you use PowerPoint? A lot of fours and fives, you got a 3, one person over here with a 1, just occasionally, nobody over, no use over there, okay, 3 over here. Okay, so we got a mix there too, all right? So it's interesting, the degree to which we use or don't use PowerPoint, but it is the medium of choice these days for a lot of courses, especially the courses that I teach, because I teach art and architectural history. So I'm very dependent upon images all the time. And PowerPoint is such a wonderful tool. I was very skeptical about it at first because I was using old 35 millimeter slides and I did not want to give them up. But as soon as I found out what the versatility of PowerPoint was, I went to that and I loved working with it all the time. While you're showing a PowerPoint, if you want your students to listen to something really important like instructions that I just gave you, how do you shut off the PowerPoint without totally shutting it down? Do you know? It's one of the 3 most important buttons you have on your laptop for PowerPoint. Just hit the B, as in boy. Hit the B button, goes black. Then hit any button, any key on your keyboard, and it comes back. If you don't like black, hit W for white, goes white. Hit any key, and it comes back. And so if you want to give instructions, or really have your students listen to something important, but you don't want them to be distracted by the image, you can use the B or the W key to do that, okay? So what are our learning goals? You know, so at the top of the handout, it asks you, what's your learning goal for this particular session? Maybe you've had a chance to look at that, maybe even jot down a note or two, but what is it that you would like to learn coming out of this session? Anybody want to volunteer a learning goal?
The kind of tips
I'm already sharing. Okay, yeah.
I'd love to learn more about just how to make PowerPoints more effective, keep them engaged, and like maybe less words on it.
Less words on it, yeah. Make them more effective so that you keep the students engaged. Okay, good. Any other learning goals?
Particularly, how can I manage the lot of equations in a PowerPoint? It's better if I write them more. How can I manage the equations in PowerPoint to engage the students?
How you manage questions in PowerPoint?
Equations.
Oh, equations. Oh, equations. Okay, equations. So you teach math-oriented courses?
Kind of.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, that's a very special area, and I haven't got a handle on equations and all the special mathematical symbols myself. It is possible, though. It takes a lot of effort, though. Okay, so I'm not sure I can give you real pointed advice right now, but anyway, we'll see. Okay, so here's one thing I think we should keep in mind when we're working with PowerPoint. We shape our PowerPoints to fit our talks, to what it is that we want to talk about. But at the same time, realize that our talks are being shaped by PowerPoint, what we can or can't do with PowerPoint. And they're being shaped by PowerPoint in the sense that our level of familiarity with all of its tools will determine what we can or can't do. The more familiar you are with it, the more you can do with it, okay? But if you're not familiar with all the tools, then you're kind of stumped at some point, and maybe you have to go back to the chalkboard or something like that and not stick with the PowerPoint. So this comes from a writing back in 2002 by Rich Gold, who was one of the first multimedia mavens and PowerPoint experts who really sat down and analyzed and assessed the value of PowerPoint, what it could and couldn't do, and how it should be used and so forth. And it's a real good touchstone in the literature on PowerPoint that alerts us still today, almost 20 years later, about the versatility of PowerPoint, but also its limitations. So I refer you to that reference. And I have a handout, a multi-page handout, which I'll pass out at the end of the session that has a bibliography and it includes that particular article as well. Okay, so when was PowerPoint first released? Does anybody know? When was it first released? PowerPoint, huh? When? 87, yes, 1987. Surprising, it's over 30 years old. But when it was first released, it wasn't released to be projected digitally like you see here. It was released to create transparencies in slides, which would be projected in the normal way through overhead projectors or slide projectors. And it was only a couple of years later that they finally migrated to this type of projection system, 1987, okay? And the man most responsible for the invention of PowerPoint is this man, Robert Gaskins. And I love this quote from him. His goal in inventing PowerPoint was to make easy things easy and hard things possible. Yeah, it's difficult to do some things that you want to do on PowerPoint, but it's possible to do them. Does anybody know for whom he originally intended PowerPoint to be invented? Who did he want to give it over to? What company? Do you know?
Business.
What?
Business.
No, what company? What digital company, tech company did he want it to give it over to?
Microsoft.
No, not originally. Max, Apple. Steve Jobs rejected it though. He never made a bid on it. And in fact, he said, people who know what they're talking about don't need PowerPoint. So on that scale that you have at the top of your handout, you might put an X there. You know, where do you stand on that spectrum from, you know, PowerPoint, it's possible, it's easy to do easy things, or versus don't use it at all? You know, think about that. Okay, so, it was then later that Microsoft made an offer for PowerPoint and they bought it. Okay, for what use was PowerPoint first conceived? Anybody?
Business,
yeah, business meetings. That's how it first came about, wanted to make those easier, right? But what's interesting is that Gaskins was mystified by the rapid adoption of PowerPoint throughout our educational system. He didn't believe it was appropriate as an educational tool because of the regimented bullet points, fragmented narrative, and so forth. He thought it was actually antithetical to our core learning objectives when we go to teach. And if that's a lot of verbiage on the screen for you to take in, yeah, it is, right? So think about presenting that sort of text this way instead, right? Maybe highlight things and ghost out things, and then the big ideas come across, right? That's one way you might handle that. PowerPoint's cognitive style is antithetical to core learning objectives, right? Much clearer that way. Okay, that's if you want to put a lot of text. You know, some people say, don't put too much text on your slides. Well, I think you can if you handle it the right way. Okay, when was death by PowerPoint coined as a term? You've heard of death by PowerPoint, right? When was it coined? Anybody want to guess? Just guess.
2001?
Yep, 2001 by Angela Garber. I don't know too much about her, but she's the one who came up with the term. You know what death by PowerPoint is, don't you? What is death by PowerPoint? This is the first point of my talk. I will read it to you anyway, so don't bother reading it. This is my second point. I am sure it helps you to listen to me as I convert digital text to spoken words. This is my third point. It's been claimed that you understand better when you read and listen to the same information simultaneously, so I am merely ensuring that you remember more. What's wrong? You're way ahead of me. Some of you have read all the way to the end before I even got there in my verbal narration, right? That's death by PowerPoint. You see how distracting it is to read? Because students are going to read way ahead of you. So you don't want to read word for word your PowerPoint, especially the slides that have a lot of text. These are useful, though, these sorts of slides, when you go load them up to Canvas, because students might want to see all that text there and study it there, okay? So, the do's and don'ts of PowerPoint. The first don't is don't read PowerPoint word for word, death by PowerPoint. If you look on your handout, I ask you somewhere there to maybe just brainstorm a couple of other don'ts real quickly in a couple of words or so. What other don'ts have you heard about PowerPoint? Don't do this, don't do that. What sorts of don'ts are floating out there?
Keep in mind that the figures that you are putting there are visible for the people, the number, the font number.
Yeah, don't use a certain font size smaller than something. What other don'ts? Don't what? Don't use more than six words across on any one line of text. What other don'ts? What? Don't use too many different colors, right? Simple color palette. Any other don'ts? Let me show you a few more. Okay, don't convey more than one main idea per slide and so forth. Don't use more than blank number of bullet points. That number varies all over depending upon who you read. Don't use more than so many words per bullet point. You know, somebody over here said six, right? So all kinds of don'ts. And the handout that I have for you at the end of the session will have all these listed there. Okay, so you don't need to worry about writing them all down. But here are some other don'ts. For example, don't use GIFs or other cheesy images. Don't use dissolves, transitions, animations, or things that spin, and don't use sound effects. I do all of that, but I do it judiciously, okay? There's a right way to use them. This is what we call a hero shot. You know what a hero shot is? It comes from marketing. That's where you have a close-up view of an individual. Often his image bleeds off the page, off the frame. And this guy, Seth Godin, he came up with his rules for PowerPoints, which he breaks immediately with the first line after the title, right? And he adds different fonts and so forth. I don't agree with any of those don'ts, except for maybe the last one. Don't hand out handouts during your PowerPoint, you know, later on, because people are distracted by the handouts and they don't work anyway if you're not there. You know how you can hand out those handouts that have the slide and then the other column, it has spaces to write notes. They don't work if you're not there present to describe things. So this whole PowerPoint presentation came about as a result of my listening to other people talk about the don'ts of PowerPoint and saying to myself, why is everything always so negative all the time? There are things you can do with PowerPoint that would really help our students learn the material a little bit better. So my whole emphasis is on things you can do with PowerPoint. Okay, so some don'ts again. These are the don'ts that you saw before. How would you break up that list so it's a little bit more manageable in terms of cognitive brain load, you know, working brain mode? How would you do that? Well, you can show them one at a time, right, like that, and talk about each one separately, so that the brain isn't overloaded like that, okay? So you put some pauses in there and they're not reading ahead of you. The students aren't reading ahead of you. And I'll just speed things up like that so you can create a whole slide like that. Okay, you can do that with PowerPoint, these animations. Or you can do it this way, right? Just have them fade in and fade out like that. And again, I'll speed it up for you, so that when we get to the very end, we have a nice list of don'ts, which the student can review one by one on their own, and then click to the next slide, which has them all there, okay?
So you normally don't make your slides available to your students before class?
No, not generally. Now, sometimes I will if it's important, but generally I don't. I'm not saying that you can't do that, but It kind of depends on what I'm talking about that particular day. Yeah. Oh, yes, definitely. I put them all up online on Canvas. Yeah, definitely. Yeah. Okay. So things that you should remember. Do remember that the power part of the word PowerPoint was meant to connote empowerment. Empowering you, the creator of the PowerPoint, to do exactly what you want to do. Gaskins once again tells us that the power part of PowerPoint was not meant to connote powerful, but empowerment, because PowerPoint was conceived to permit the originators of content to control the entirety of their presentations. They didn't have to go to some media specialist. They could do it directly and personally all by themselves. In other words, Gaskins was determined to make easy things easy and hard things what? Make hard things possible. Yeah. Okay. So what other do's are there? Well, Gaskins and the other designers of PowerPoint rejected appeals from people who said, you know, people are producing just terrible PowerPoints. They're terrible. You've got to put limits on this. And Gaskins says, no, I'm not going to do that. You know, he didn't want all PowerPoints to look exactly the same because he discovered that there were a lot of legitimate but non-standard uses that PowerPoint was being employed for, like the educational setting. So that's why there are so many bells and whistles for special tasks in PowerPoint. Okay, that's why he put them there in part. And so the judicious use of PowerPoint, I contend, promotes learning. One thing to keep in mind, do this, pictorial supremacy effect. The eye goes to the picture. Remember, you can have a picture and text on the same slide, but where's the eye gonna go first? To the picture, okay? And it doesn't matter how much text you have on a slide. If there's a picture there, the picture can be surrounded by text, but the student's eye is gonna go first to the picture. Okay, so keep that in mind. And then other things related to pictures, that we process them more quickly than words, that dual coded information, that is to say text along with pictures or narration along with pictures, is very effective as a teaching technique. The brain is wired to pay attention to things that move, and it can create a learning community if a PowerPoint is developed well. And again, this is gonna be in the handout I'll have at the end. But the most important point is the last one. Verbal gloss is absolutely critical to the success of a PowerPoint. What's verbal gloss? What I'm doing right now, the narration, explaining things, pointing things out. That's critical to the success of a PowerPoint. Okay, so those are the ones I want to concentrate on a little bit. Now, this is a study that came out in 1982. What's significant about that date? 5 years before PowerPoint, right? Already we were concerned about how students learn best through pictures, audio, or print, what I'm calling images, narration, or text. And this is a critical study because it found out some interesting stuff about dual coding information. And what this study did was to take a bunch of grade school students and test them through a multiple choice quiz on their knowledge of cheetahs. The control group had nothing coming into the test, just whatever they happened to know prior to the test. That was the control group. But then they broke the rest of the students up into three groups. And one group got only images, nothing else. Another group got only audio narration, nothing else. And the third group got text, written text, and nothing else. And then they quizzed the students, and these are the results. If you put it on a 100-point scale, you know, image alone, 70-some percent. Narration alone, almost 80%. Text, a little bit over 80%. Text, in terms of long-term retention of information, text is better than either narration or image alone. Okay, so don't underestimate the importance of text. But here's what they also found out. When they dual-coded information and presented narration with text or image with text or image with narration, the scores went up dramatically. Just dual coding them. And look which is the most dramatic of the dual coded texts, dual coded forms of information, images and narration. Images alone with your verbal gloss, that's the most effective way to convey information. If you add then text to it, it's only a marginal improvement, okay? So the students who were shown images were shown a video without narration, just a video. And I want to show you a similar sort of video here of a cheetah. I want you to ask yourself as you're looking at this, what kind of tricks do you see being used here that you can maybe employ in your PowerPoints? Because everything you see here is virtually possible with PowerPoint. It takes a little bit of hard work, but you can do it. Okay, so ask yourself, you know, how effective is this video in terms of combining narration, text, images, and what can I copy from it?
Cheetahs. You probably already know they're the world's fastest land animal. They can go from 0 to 60 in 3 seconds, covering the length of an Asian elephant with each stride. But here are 5 things you probably didn't know about cheetahs. Cheetahs are one of the few big cats that can't roar. Instead, these carnivores purr, much like a house cat. Also, they chirp loudly enough to be heard a mile away.
Okay, I'm gonna stop it there. What things did you pick upon that were particularly effective? The movement of the animal itself, but also the movement of the images. Yeah, you go from a lion to a cheetah to a house cat, they moved across. You can do that with PowerPoint. Okay, what else did you notice?
Sound.
What about the sound?
It adds to the image.
Yeah, and it was synced. The narration was synced to what you were seeing. There was no time separation. It was exactly on the same beat. What else did you notice? What?
The text.
The text? Yeah, the text helped a lot, right? And the numbers, and you saw the cheetah bounding across, and there was an elephant right there when they were explaining how it, in one leap, can travel the distance of the length of an elephant, right? Anything else that you noticed? How about the yellow borders? Yeah, and did you notice how the videos were carefully selected too, so that when the lion stops roaring, then the image moves to the cheetah, and when the cheetah stops purring, the cheetah turns its head towards the house cat and a yellow border appears around that. You can do that with PowerPoint. It takes a little bit of work, but you can do that. I'm not saying that video was produced with PowerPoint. They probably had a very similar sort of software program, but you can do those sorts of things with PowerPoint, okay? All right, so that graph that you saw before, it's rather static, right? But with PowerPoint, you can choose to show which bars you want to show at which point. Right, to have a greater impact. And so you're not overloading the cognitive workings of the brain. So maybe we show just those bars at first, okay? Then we add this one, image and narration. And you see how much more dramatic the results are when you combine dual code, image and narration. They trump text, narration, or image alone. And then you can add the other bars to show you how image and narration still trump everything. And there's the last triple coded one, not much marginal gain, right? So you can do that with PowerPoint. Okay, now go back to this slide. Actually, I wanted to show you something. Do you know, PowerPoint, when you're developing it, is very linear. And you think that when you present PowerPoint, you have to go slide by slide by slide. Let's suppose you want to go back to an earlier slide. We're on slide number 43, something like that. What if I wanted to go back to slide number 9? How do I do that? Anybody know? You just type in 9, hit enter, and there we are. Okay? Now, but you have to have a list of your PowerPoint slides with the numbers so you know which number to hit. Now, how do you go back to number 43? You can punch in 43, right, and do it the same way, or you can right click and there's a box that comes up. It's not showing up there, but there's a box that comes up, a drop-down list, and if you hit last viewed, then you come back to the original slide. So that prevents you from continually hitting that button again and again and again to go backward or forward, okay? So there we are. So let's break some rules, okay? There's one transition, just fracturing. What I found out about my ancestry, to go back to my Siberian ancestors, you know, I'm 99.7% European, Russian, Ukrainian, Romanian, Croatian, Slovenian, Slovakian, East Austrian, Italian, and French, and 0.03% Siberian, which is kind of cool. I'm embracing that. I really love that fact. It got me interested. You know, how did I get that Siberian ancestry? And it told me that my Siberian ancestor, who was 100% Siberian, lived somewhere around the late 1600s, early 1700s. And I thought to myself, what's happening in the late 1600s and early 1700s? Well, Russia is expanding eastward across Asia under Tsar Peter the Great. All that kind of salmon color that you see there on the map, right? So somewhere back when, I had some ancestor who moved eastward with Peter the Great, married some little pretty Siberian gal, or maybe it was the other way around. Some Siberian man came westward to back to Moscow, married some pretty little Russian woman, and here I am, 9 generations later. That's kind of cool. Okay, so now what I want to segue to is this, a map of the world, okay? This is the Dymaxion global map that was concocted by Bucky Fuller. You may know him for the geodesic dome. But what he was trying to show in this map was, well, two things. First thing, he was really discontent with standard maps of the world because they distorted the sizes of continents and countries. On a lot of maps, you might notice that Greenland is almost as large as the continent of Africa. He thought that was terribly unfair and was not representational of how the world really was. So he came up with a 20-sided figure made up of 20 equilateral triangles, which could be unfolded flat, like you see there on the screen, and reveal the real dimensions and proportions of the continents and the countries. Okay, that was his first goal. Now, if I'm teaching a class of 200 students, which I sometimes am, and I want to talk about the globe and maps, you know, I can have a little paper model, cardboard model like that, which I actually have and show the students, but the students in the back can't see that. So what I can do is I can violate one of the don'ts that say, don't use GIFs, right? And I could put that in instead. Watch that. Isn't that cool? That's how it unfolds. See it? And then we fold it back up. And because GIFs repeat over and over again, the students can study that without actually putting their hands on the actual paper model of the thing. Okay. Now, the other goal that Bucky Fuller had was to show that, looked at from certain perspectives, the world can be thought of as a planet of water in which there is one island. Look at the continents as they're laid out there. Not typical, but they're all connected. And back in the prehistoric days, there were land bridges between Siberia and Alaska. That's how so-called Native Americans got over here to North America, by going over the land bridge from Siberia. So you can show that with a map that has arrows like that, how we all came out of Africa and moved across the world on this single island, irregular island, but a single island, right? That's pretty effective. But what if you were to animate it like that? See how populations just explode and how they move from one part of the world to another? I think that makes an impression on students, right, to show that. So that's what you can do with PowerPoint, okay? I teach history courses, and sometimes it's important that we give students an idea of relative chronologies and timelines and things like that. And so I developed this animated timeline that shows magnitudes of orders of magnitude going from 3 million years BC to 300,000 years BC to 30,000 years BC. And I'll show this in class, and I can pause it. I can set the PowerPoint up so I can pause it and talk about each segment one at a time. Here I'm speeding things up for you. But what's nice about PowerPoint is that you can save it as PDFs, and then you can take that PDF and print it out and give it to the students so they have a handout or a summary. It's another advantage of PowerPoint. Here's another one I developed for medieval milestones. Oops, what's happening there? Did it freeze on me? Uh-oh. Technical problem. Let me see if I can get out of this. It's not supposed to do that. The whole thing froze up on me, Tucker. Ben, help. Wait a second. Oh. Sorry about that, folks.
Too fast,
fast? Oh, okay, we have to do this again. Oh, there we go. All right. Okay, here we go. I forgot where it was now. What slide number? Oops. I'm sorry about this, everybody. Here we go. Okay. I need to change the settings. See that? See Ben, what I was saying about the darn settings. It's going to take me just another minute, but maybe in that minute I can multitask. And answer any questions you might have if you want to yell them out.
Is there in order to create a GIF, you have to go outside PowerPoint, create your GIF or GIF or whatever.
way. Yeah.
And embed it, right?
You insert it and you embed it right into the PowerPoint. And I don't create the GIFs. I find them online. Yeah, I'm not that technically proficient to know how to actually create a GIF. It is possible. There is software out there to do that sort of thing. Okay, here we go. I think we're back on track. Yeah, you insert it. There are this button right up here, insert. You click on that and you can insert text boxes and.
And so for copyright reasons, do you have something at the end?
Nope. No, I'm sorry to say I don't pay attention to copyright. I go by fair use laws. That's how I was taught as a student myself. You know, what is it? Maximum 10% from any one source. And so I make sure I stay beneath that. I need to do this. Okay, yeah. I know I probably should be more concerned about that, but I'm not, there we go. I'm not selling these PowerPoints or anything like that, so. There we go, there's the timeline, okay. I don't know why I froze up like that. Ben, you'll have to tell me later why you think it is. That's the first time that ever happened to me, but I'm not gonna bore you with the whole timeline, so I'll just fill in all the rest, okay? All right, so, Il Camino, it's a pilgrimage route that was famous from the Middle Ages, still is today, where you can take this pilgrimage route from the Pyrenees, the border between France and Spain, and go all the way to Santiago de Compostela in northwestern Spain to see the shrine of St. James the Great. Okay, and what I can do is I could stand here and, if I'm tall enough, I could point out that route right there, 500 miles. But if it's way up high, I have to bring in my pool cue. When I started teaching 42 years ago, I went out to Kmart because I had to point out things on the screen in class, and I didn't have anything to point with, and my arm's not long enough, so I bought a pool cue. I still have it with me today. I'm gonna get it bronzed when I retire. But even that wouldn't reach in some instances. So look what you can do with PowerPoint. You can highlight the path that way, okay? So we've got the BW, we got the B and the W buttons on keyboards. The third most important button is the back button. You can go back, don't be afraid to go backwards. You don't have to be linear forward all the time. Go back and repeat so that the students can pick it up. If they didn't catch it the first time, maybe they'll catch it the second time, right? Why is that important? Because when you are in a situation like this, you aren't gonna be able to point things out physically. Right? Look at how they've readapted that room and the screen is way up there. All right, creates a dissonance in the student's mind because who do they look at, you down below or the screen up above? So you can create a virtual pointer. You can be a virtual pointer if you include it within your PowerPoint, right? Or look at situations like this. What's that guy pointing to on the left? Yeah. And which screen? You know, you got up there, you got three screens, but they're kind of folded out this way. And then in the other situation, you've got three screens, but they're folded back this way. Where does a student know where to look, right? That's the problem with some of these architectural spaces. Here are two spaces. You might be familiar with at least one of them up at the top, leadership studies. Ever notice the screens in there? Way up high, so I can't point to them. Not even my pool cue will get to them, and they're this way, right? So where do I look? Where does the student look? Which screen do I point to if I could point, right? So the room I prefer there is down below. That's my lecture room in Seton Hall. I love it because it's down at lower ground level and I can walk across the screen and point things out. So here's the question. When you put your PowerPoints up online, you aren't there. How do the students know what's important if you aren't there to point things out to them? So you can use PowerPoint to do that, okay? We talk about in my class, two medieval styles, Romanesque and Gothic. Here are two plans, respectively, Romanesque and Gothic. And one of the points I want to make to my students is how these churches have exactly the same parts, but they're put together a little bit differently. And yet I couldn't find a way to convey to the students how you're looking at the same parts, but just kind of assembled slightly differently, just using the black and white line drawings of the plans. So you know what you can do with PowerPoint? You can color code. You can apply colors over the plan like that and can create a key. And one important point here is when you do this sort of thing, be aware of this concept known as mapping, mapping where the order of the colors down below here reiterate the order that you see them in the plan. So pink is up above and then lavender and then blue and green and so forth. Mapping, that helps the students to make a connection. Yeah. Yeah, I did all the shading myself using PowerPoint. There's a tool where you can insert geometrical forms and you can change the transparency of them, how much you can see through them, you know, 100% opaque to just 10% transparent or something like that, you know. And then that way the lines, the black lines don't disappear. Yeah.
I have another question. So I've used PowerPoint a lot, but did you just self-teach yourself to try and learn?
That's a good
question. Yeah. Like,
yeah. That's a really good question. Okay. How did I learn how to do it? It was trial and error. I never took a course. I just experimented and eventually found all these tools and explored deep down a couple layers and you'll find things, you know. And I always kept in mind one important fact. Whenever you're dealing with any sort of digital technology, there's always an undo button. If you don't like what you've done, undo it, right? It's that simple. I just kept that in mind and, you know, yeah. And so I learned on my own, yeah. I do have one reference at the end of the handout I have at the end of the session here. There are all sorts of videos online that you can consult, but I was just adventurous. I said, I'm gonna do this, you know, just experiment. Okay, so if you don't like that, and if you want to convey to the students the several, you know, Tucker?
Oh, I just have a quick question. Do you ever, or have you ever had issues with students who have difficulties with making distinctions between red and green?
Between red and, that's a good question. No, it's something I've been thinking about lately, and I need to be more aware of that. It just dawned on me when I was doing this sort of thing within the last year. Do you wonder if some students are going to be able to pick up on those color differences if they're so-called colorblind, red and green and so forth? And no student has ever approached me about that. Maybe they're too bashful or shy. But I wish I did know who those students were and then I could help them, you know. I wonder if the Access Center screens for that sort of condition. It'd be interesting to find out if they do, because that is a consideration, I think. Okay, so now I want to talk about the individual parts. And I want to show the students that you can talk about these parts individually. Like there's the chancel, we'll take it away and we'll talk about the ambulatory and we'll make it move because ambulatory is the aisle around which you amble or walk. We'll take that away and we'll look at the absidials, which you visit as a pilgrim one by one. We'll take those away, okay, and maybe start with the chancel again. And you can compound and combine these things. So you can start talking about that and you can start talking about that, right? And I'm just gonna add to it. And this gets to that whole notion there, parts versus the whole. It's all the same parts, but in the Romanesque, you see the individual parts, you can almost pluck them out individually. Whereas in the Gothic, it's the same parts, but they've become fused or merged. And the color coding helps the students to understand that concept and the difference between the two styles. Alexander the Great, what do you know about his physical appearance? He wasn't typically Greek or Macedonian. He didn't have dark ruddy skin and dark hair and dark eyes. He had pale skin and blonde hair and eyes of different color, one blue as the sky and one dark. Wouldn't it be nice to see him in color? You can do that with PowerPoint. Ancient sculpture had color added to it. It was painted. Wouldn't it be nice to see the original appearance of ancient antique sculpture? Or how about gifts? Cheesy gifts. You know, it's a place to become kind of lighthearted, especially when your topic for the day is how to make a mummy, right? Or as I like to call it, mummies for dummies. You can get that template and just add to it, right? Or when I'm talking about it, you know, step one, prepare the body. Step two, dry out the body. Step three, wrap up the body. Step four, box up the body. What have I just shown you? The four major points, the four chapter headings. Then what I do is I go back and repeat each one of those, but with secondary slides right after each one that go into more detail. But it helps to orient the student right at the start of the lecture. Okay, these are the four major points. Okay, sometimes it's nice to have an image up on the screen as the students come into the room. Gets them wondering, gee, I wonder where we are. What are we gonna talk about today? Where are we? Anybody wanna guess? A desert somewhere, what? Namibia? No? Close. Sahara, the Egyptian desert. And do you see how I faded out or darkened the background slide image of the sand dunes? They're still there, but now the title punches out too at the same time. Backgrounds are important. So we go on and talk about mummies and so forth, or maybe have that on the screen, Abu Simbel, right? You're familiar with that great Egyptian temple. That's pretty pretty eye-arresting as the students come in the room to see that gigantic figure of Ramesses II. Here's some details. I don't know if you know or not. I'm gonna go to the magnify button or tool once again, and I wanna show you something. You know, sometimes we load up our slides with a lot of information, multiple images and so forth, but if you zoom in, you find out that at the top of the Temple of Abu Simbel, there are baboons there. And what you can do is you can use your buttons on your keyboard, you know, left or right buttons, the arrow buttons, and you can move that around like that and come back down to a view of a baboon, right? Hit escape, there we are. Okay, now, the reason baboons are on this temple is because they were considered by the Egyptians to be watchers of the dawn, sun worshipers. Baboons, it was noted, would screech and howl at sunrise, right? So they chase away the darkness and welcome the sun through their howling. Wouldn't it be nice to add a sound effect? What does a baboon sound like when he howls? You can do that with PowerPoint. Just insert audio, audio clips, yeah. Is he ever gonna stop here? Okay, I think he's done. There you go, okay. Or how about this, as a prelude to our discussion of early Christianity and its humble origins. That gets it across to the students right away in the first slide, right? Or, here's a style I call, this is the Dutch style known as De Stijl. That image that you see there punctuates what the style is all about, primary colors and white and black and so forth, simple geometrical shapes, nondescript. But a little hint here, when you're using lettering on a white background, you might want to step down the pure black a couple of steps down to a dark charcoal. Then the contrast won't be so great. It'll be a little bit easier on the eye. Because if the word, the style here were pure black, they would be the darkest thing on the screen, even the blacks that you think you see in the image. So think about stepping down the color gradation a little bit and using black lettering on white. Or here, this slide for the Art Nouveau, where the text itself conveys the essence of what the style is all about, right? Why am I using green here as my background color? Pardon me? Because my lettering is white. Why else might I be using green? The rug is green. Why is the rug green? It's the Islamic color. It's the color most associated with Islam. And so you use that green background all throughout your PowerPoint, and subliminally you're sending the message to the students, oh, green is important for this reason or another. Okay, so when I have another PowerPoint on Islam, I use green once again, just to reinforce it. You can change the background color. Okay, how are we doing on time? About 5 minutes left, Tucker? Okay, so one point I like to make to my students is when we're talking about religion, why is it that all of the monotheistic religions, the great monotheistic religions, Judaism, Christianity, Islam, they all originated in the desert, whereas the polytheistic religions tended to originate in terrains that were had a wide range of topographies, mountains and valleys and forests and hills and prairies and so forth. Why is that? Through images and even gifts, I can reinforce the fact that monotheistic religions originated in deserts because the world view, all they knew of, was this desert that stayed the same all the time, therefore one creator. Whereas in landscapes that had a lot of variety, you had to come up with different sorts of deities to explain each natural phenomenon. And so polytheism, in Europe especially, right? Think of Game of Thrones and dragons and things like that. So this helps to convey that big idea to the students through image. Did you see the witch fly by? Okay. But then you're going to need something else, especially for the students who want to review this later and be reminded of the big idea. So you drop in the big idea like that. Okay. Or if you're making transitions within a PowerPoint, I like to take the buildings on the Acropolis in Athens one at a time. But to indicate to the students that we're switching now from this building to another, I use these sorts of images here. You can take an ordinary photograph, and there are options within PowerPoint to convert it to a sketch or painting-like image. This looks like a watercolor. Nope, that's through PowerPoint. Just hit a button on PowerPoint to change the photograph to that watercolor. Here's another one. Looks like a watercolor, right? But here's the original photograph. You can do that on PowerPoint. And it helps the students to see, we're moving on to the next one, especially if you do it consistently, right? Or, talking about specialty fonts. Not supposed to use specialty fonts, right? Because not every computer has the Disney font. That's why I have to use my own laptop, because the computer here won't have the Disney font. But if you're talking about Disney, and I've given this presentation where we talk about the Imagineering tricks, about 8 or 10 of them, separate tricks, you want to use the Disney font, right? It just fits. But then I have to make it clear to the people in attendance at the talk, we're moving from one Imagineering trick to another. How do we do that? We can do that. Total immersion, what Disney meant by it, how it's used in the parks, how might you use it in your classroom, right? And then we go to the next Imagineering trick. And again, we use that rather dramatic transition. Okay, plussing, how it's used in the parks, what you might do in your class, and so on. Okay, you can flip the page. And because we're running short on time, I'm going to skip over this. I'll just go through it real quick. But somebody was asking about blackboards and that sort of thing, and how do you convey, you know, something that needs a little bit more fluidity and spontaneity in how you deliver the material. You can approximate that with PowerPoint. You know, in my lecture room, the whiteboard is behind the screen. So I have to lift the screen up to get to the whiteboard. That's not very convenient. So I've had to find a way in PowerPoint to approximate the same sort of spontaneity of using a chalkboard. Okay, so we'll skip over that. Oh, how about this, mathematics, you know. Want to show students how to construct a golden section rectangle? What I do is I do it first on the chalkboard, and then I turn to this so that they can see me do it first physically, you know, using my own hands and arms, and then they have this to look at during class, and they can go back and review it afterwards when it's loaded up onto Canvas. I'm almost done, Tucker. Okay, golden section spiral. You see it in nautilus shells, in ocean waves, and in hurricanes. Don't use things that spin. You can. Okay, how about this? Little lecture I have on Frank Lloyd Wright. All right, and I'm gonna go through this rather quickly. His plans look kind of confusing. Where are the spaces? Where are the walls that divide one room from another? I go into Photoshop, I remove some of the extraneous lines, and I get that, a constellation of structural supports. And then from there, I'm able to highlight the spaces, how they define spaces, even though they aren't walls. And then I can indicate the grid around which Frank Lloyd Wright placed those structural supports. Draw straight lines from one pier to another, like that, back and forth, crisscrossing. Remind you of anything? Weaving, maybe? That's why we call his plans tartan plans. So I add some tartan colors there. You can do that with PowerPoint. There's the original plan again, okay? Now, I'm gonna hit the button once here on my remote. I gave a talk once on using Facebook to study Frank Lloyd Wright, and while I was teaching that class, Facebook changed their format. And so I wanted to convey to the people that it's the same exact stuff that Facebook had once been, but just rearranged. And I wanna show you how they rearranged it. Watch, one push. No hands, Mom. Okay. There you go. Put a dot on it at the end. okay? So you wanna see how I did that? Gaskins wanted to make easy things easy, but hard things possible. And it is hard sometimes to do that. This is a screenshot showing the animation pane that appears over to the side, and you see all of the different buttons, tools I had to click in order to get it to do all that, okay? So it is possible. It took hours and hours for me to do that, but that's my therapy. Just like my grandmother and mother used to knit and crochet, just relax. That's what I do at night. I just relax and put together a new PowerPoint. Can I make it do this? Can I make it move? Yeah, I can do that. Okay, so pretty intimidating. So how do you start? Think billboard, real simple. And then graduate to this, movie trailers or opening title sequence of movies like this one. Watch for the yellow arrow. See, pointing out Leonardo DiCaprio. It appears again, there's Tom Hanks. Okay. You can do that. You can come very close to that in PowerPoint, not exactly, but glean some ideas for it. How do I handle text fading in or out or its placement on the larger field? How do I handle movement, animations, things that move off the frame and so forth? How do I transition from one scene to another? Movie trailers and opening title sequences give us a real good idea, a repository of wonderful ideas to be used. Here's my favorite one. Fade in. Fade out. You can do that with PowerPoint and then. Lower the volume a little bit there, but do you notice how occasionally in this crawl, how slow it's going, so people can keep pace with it. They can even go back a little bit if they're slow readers. And notice how some words are all caps to highlight them. You can do that in PowerPoint. You might have seen me use it once or twice in previous slides in this presentation. Okay, so I wanna get to the end. I'm gonna lower the sound a little bit, but I wanna get to the end of this crawl. I hope there are no spoilers in it for anybody who hasn't seen it yet, even though the film's been out for 7 weeks already. But here's my favorite word at the end of the crawl. There it is, power, right? It's within your power. Okay, so here's are the do's. And the last one, verbal gloss. That's what makes a PowerPoint successful. To see the zoom? That's another tool you can use. It's right there in PowerPoint. Okay, so parting words, just another form of writing on walls. That's all PowerPoint is. And we've been writing on walls since the beginning of time, back in cave days, okay? And it's within your power uniquely as a PowerPoint presenter to point out to all the rest of us just exactly how to read the writing on the walls. So thank you very much for your attention. And I know you've got things to do and places to go. So I think I'll just set these stacks up front on either side of this front table, and feel free to pick one up. And if you have any questions, please feel free to contact me, okay? And I wanna thank you once again for your kind attention. Thank you.